We are rolling through the program. Appreciate all of you hanging out with us. NFL, obviously. We are all in on the NFL. It was an injury-belabored madhouse all day Sunday, all through the evening. So many big injuries going on and so many impactful outcomes already. We just spent a lot of time talking about the Cowboys-Falcons and the Chargers-Chiefs game. And, Dub, one of the things we were talking about is the difference between being 0-2 and 2-0, which anybody out there who's an NFL fan knows has become very significant as kind of an early line of demarcation as it pertains to playoff chances. And I don't want to sound like Jim Mora, playoffs, but it's never too early to start talking about the larger playoff picture. And there were a lot of different moving parts, teams that I thought looked really good getting to 2-0. We've already talked about Sunday Night Football, but Dub, the stat that I was talking about in the last segment of 2-0 versus 0-2, and again, it can be a little bit different now because you have one more playoff team, but it's pretty amazing the difference between 2-0 and 2-2.
Absolutely. This is since 1990.
Yep.
Teams that start 2-0, they make the playoffs 61.3% of the time. And of those 2-0 teams, 8% of the teams that win the Super Bowl started 2-0, and that's the highest percentage. So that's a big number there. But on the flip side, 0-2, you only have a 12.6% chance of making the playoffs. So, I mean, weeks 1 and 2, I think right there, that shows you how big of a deal that is.
Yeah, it's pretty remarkable that that would be that those data points would be that seismic after just 2 weeks. And I don't think it's crazy to talk about a bunch of these different teams that are 2-0 and who has looked the best. And I think, beyond a shadow of a doubt, you tell me if you think I'm crazy, but I would argue that the Packers, of the teams we haven't talked about so far, the Packers, Aaron Rodgers is playing like a man possessed right now. They were dominant against the Vikings. They were dominant yesterday, taking down the Detroit Lions. They have won both of their games by substantial margins. Their offense has gone over 40 points both games. Well, I know one of those was a pick six yesterday, but let's just continue to roll there. And then, look, I think the Rams and the Cardinals in the NFC West have both looked really, really good. And to me, Kyler Murray, remember how angry people got? Like, there was this anti-Cliff Kingsbury contingent out there. They looked at his Texas Tech record, and they said, oh, my goodness, how in the world does Cliff Kingsbury deserve the job? Look at what he did at Texas Tech. And by the way, a lot of those same people also said when Patrick Mahomes was drafted, oh, look at the guy's record at Texas Tech. He couldn't win big games. Why is he getting drafted in the top 10? And Kyler Murray, to me, I watch some of the things that he does right now, and I think, goodness, that looks like complete genius now of the Arizona Cardinals to pair him with Cliff Kingsbury. And remember all that drama that came out? Because Kingsbury, when he still had that Texas Tech job, he was talking about how good Kyler Murray looked, and he was like, oh, I'd take him number one overall. And everybody just kind of thought that was hyperbole. And then, lo and behold, the Arizona Cardinals end up with the number one pick, and they hire Cliff Kingsbury, and he goes out and he gets Kyler Murray. Man, I look at what Kyler Murray is doing and also what DeAndre Hopkins has added to that offense. And I look right now at the Houston Texans, and this is not crazy talk because I made this argument before the season started. My bold prediction was that the Arizona Cardinals were going to win the NFC West. And it doesn't look insane right now, although the Rams also look pretty outstanding with what they did going on the road against the Eagles. But Kyler Murray looks like he could have an MVP-like season. If you haven't watched him play yet, there are things he does that are flat out almost without parallel. Now, you could maybe say there's a little bit of Lamar to him, but I think Kyler Murray is just much more of an accurate thrower. And I'm not trying to take a shot at Lamar Jackson. People are all sensitive. Like, anytime you say anything other than Lamar Jackson's the greatest human being who's ever existed, I like what Kyler Murray can do surveying the field more than I like what Lamar Jackson can do. And that's not a slight against Lamar Jackson. It's just looking at Kyler Murray right now, I think he could be the MVP this year. Now, I feel like every positive story that you say about anybody has to be followed because of the injury list that we're on right now. by saying provided that they can stay healthy, because I think that's going to be the caveat that follows everybody this season. And not just because of COVID. So far, the NFL teams have done a phenomenal job with guys not testing positive for COVID. At some point, the NFL will likely have a bunch of players, I think. I hope it doesn't happen. But I think just raw probability, because there's so many guys on the teams, maybe after a month they start taking a few more chances. Maybe they're out a little bit more. Maybe they're not as afraid. I don't know. But so far there haven't been COVID-related injury issues. But it seems like the fear of allowing as much contact might have created a lot of people who are susceptible to injury in the NFL. Now, let me say this. There also are always a lot of guys that get injured in an NFL preseason too. So what you really would have to do is analyze the number of severe injuries and season-ending injuries through 6 weeks, the four preseason weeks plus the first two of the NFL. But there were a lot of guys dropping like crazy on Sunday, and a lot of really big names. Saquon Barkley, Nick Bosa, even Drew Lock, who people are just kind of getting used to. I mean, the number of guys getting injured and coming off the field is pretty wild. But I look at, look, my Titans are 2-0, and I'm excited that they're 2-0. They haven't looked that great, right? I mean, there's a difference between the way teams can look on 2-0, and of the teams that we're talking about right now that we didn't talk about Sunday Night Football-wise, Titans 2-0, Packers 2-0, Bills 2-0, Rams 2-0, Steelers 2-0, Cardinals 2-0, right? Titans could easily be 0-2. To their credit, they found a way to win. Steven Gostkowski, who missed three field goals and an extra point last week, comes back, bangs through two long field goals yesterday. Titans get to 2-0, first time since 2008. Again, I apologize to anybody who had to sit near us with my kids going crazy. I had them all out at Buffalo Wild Wings. We had a ton of young kids watching there. We had an awesome day, all right? But the Titans, to me, are very wobbly 2-0. Still way better to be a wobbly 2-0 than 1-1 or 0-2, but they haven't looked like a world-beating team. The Bills are 2-0. And as good as Josh Allen looked, going for over 300 yards first two games that he's played so far, wobbly, right? If you're a Bills fan, you know what I'm talking about. They came out strong against the Jets. The Jets are awful, atrocious. It was a bad bet by me. Had a lot of good bets over the weekend. Going to start giving you a six-pack of bets for the NFL as well as my picks for college football. And again, I encourage you to go sign up if you like to gamble like I do. FanDuel.com/Clay. You get $1,000 free to gamble with at FanDuel.com/Clay. Great gambling picks this weekend. A lot of good results. But the Bills are 2-0. But I would say it's a little bit of a wobbly 2-0. They were trailing late against the Dolphins. They found a way to win. They didn't have a very good second half against the Jets. 2-0 is 2-0, but a wobbly 2-0. I think the Steelers 2-0 is wobbly. They had a couple of bad passes from Daniel Jones in week one that helped the Steelers. They got Drew Lock injured. Looked like the Broncos might even be able to steal one against the Steelers late. Wobbly 2-0. Rams, dominant. Sean McVay looks back to his "I'm Sean McVay, bitches" play calling status. He kind of lost his swagger there for a little while. I watched a lot of that game. Jared Goff was throwing darts, and everybody was open all over the field for them. I'm nervous if I'm an Eagle fan with this 0-2 start, but I think the Rams looked incredible, Packers looked incredible, and the Cardinals looked incredible as we're trying to break down all of the 2-0 teams and kind of put into context who has stood out so far. And we'll do top five, bottom five on Tuesday, which we do regularly on this show. And then the other team that I need to mention is the Baltimore Ravens. I mean, the Baltimore Ravens just went in to Houston and dominated the Texans. And I told you on this show that I think the Texans are going to start 1-6 or 2-5, that I believe DeAndre Hopkins is a security blanket being gone is going to be a major issue for Deshaun Watson. and that I'm not a fan of Bill O'Brien or what he has created there. And the Ravens have not missed a beat from what they were able to do last season. Bears are also 2-0. Not really sold on the Bears. They're a wobbly 2-0. Again, they could have lost both of those games, maybe should have lost both of those games. But that's how I would kind of break down where we are right now as we finish off the NFL week one. All right, when we come back, more NFL talk to start off the second hour. I'll dive back into Sunday Night Football. We'll talk about what, if anything, we learned from the big game between the Patriots and the Seahawks. And then we'll talk with Joel Klatt. So if you're a big college football fan, the SEC is back. We're going to have a fun conversation with him. His game got canceled, so he's joining us on Monday again. All of that still to come. I appreciate all of you hanging out with us. This is Outkick the Coverage on Fox Sports Radio.